Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the first round of the GPBWC Formula Challenge 2013. My name is Liam Jenkins, and we're here today in a rainy Albert Park, and with me for all the action is Mr. Lee Morris. So, Lee, how are you today?
Better now it's dry, Liam, unfortunately. It has dried out for this session, I forgot to mention that to you. Unfortunately, Liam's having some issues at the moment, so he can't actually see the live action. So we'll try and do our best. But yeah, very well, mate.
Awesome. So hopefully my technical issues get fixed as soon as possible, so I can't actually see what's going on at the circuit at the moment. So what I will do is hand you over to Lee Morris, who will take control of the final part of qualifying and keep you all up to date with what's going on the circuit.
Yeah, thank you. Hopefully we can get your issues sorted for the race. We'll get you involved in this, definitely. I mean, Liam is supposed to be the lead commentator of this broadcast. But for now, I'm the only one who can see the live action, and it is bone dry, as you can see on track, and at the moment, it's a familiar face up front. We were going to do a team's preview, as there are about, let's see how many drivers are on track at the moment. There are 42 cars on track at the moment, so it's pretty insane out there. We were going to do a team's preview of every driver, but with the issues we've had, we haven't really got time to do that, unfortunately, because there are only 8 minutes left, and this is qualifying. So this is like a crucial stage of the first race. So you just have to bear with us, because I don't think even me and Liam know the actual full lineup at the moment, unfortunately. But a familiar name up front, you're watching him on the screen now, it's Benjamin Zerka for Logix Razor Motorsports on a 138.508. Close in behind is also another familiar name. There he is on the screen, just going very slowly without a rear wing, actually. Looks like he's been involved in some contact there. But Ryan Gilmore for Simink Motorsport is up in second position. And the track is so crowded, it's unbelievable. You can see cars. Every shot we go to, there's cars on the screen. Third place is Tuomas Koriala, I hope I pronounced your name correctly, for Sisu Grand Prix on a 138.8. It's changing all the time, so you really got to bear with us on this one. This is the worst start to a broadcast in history, I believe. Jarl Tien, also another familiar name to the GPWC for Squire Motorsports, is in fourth position, just about to come across the start-finish line, actually, looking back there from his rear-view wing. He goes across the line to start a hot lap. In fifth position, another famous name, actually, again, from the Formula Challenge last year, I believe, was Adrian McNaughton for Storm Racing. He's stuck with the same team this year, and you can see him stuck behind one of the other cars there, not quite sure who that is at the moment. And a very, very famous name, almost a celebrity name at the moment, is, well, the position's changing all the time, can't keep up with this at the moment. Jack Nichols there in 7th position for JRT. Someone's moved up on the grid, and it's Gaxella. Wow, what a time that is. Emmanuel Gaxella, you may as well remember his name from last year. He's done a 137.6 and gone to the pole position, 6 tenths faster than Benjamin Zerka for the Logix team. Again, you'll have to bear with us, because this is really, at the moment, it's just madness on track. Looking now at Gaxella, who is on the provisional pole at this moment in time. There are 6 minutes left of the session. Get you on board with Emmanuel as he heads down into the fast left and right section at Albert Park. He's up slightly in his own pole time at the moment. Bear with me a few seconds, a few more issues. Oh, as Gaxella comes around the final few corners now. We will take you on an onboard lap, actually. Actually, no, he's going into the pit, so we won't do that. I believe Benjamin Zerka is coming around to start a hot lap. He's currently actually on one at the moment, and he goes very wide through that corner there. Apologies for the intermittent commentary, I'm just trying to get some issues sorted. Ryan Gilmore in fifth position is coming around to start a hot lap, and we'll go on board with him and do an entire lap as we head down into Jones and Brabham. I've not actually driven this car myself, I'm not quite sure how they handle it, but they look very nippy indeed. And they're very agile as well. He's got traffic in front of him, unfortunately. That is Jack Nichols in front, actually, who's also just out of the hot lap, I believe. Now heading through the Sports Centre into Hellas, and now Whiteford, the flat out right hand this car's a little downforce, flat out. Awesome corner into Albert Road, past the marina. Obviously Albert Park centred on the big lake in the middle. But the fact that Jack Nicklaus is behind him on the grid, he's actually pulling away at the moment, so Jack doing a great job. Now into the Clark Fittipaldi chicane. For any sound issues, I will take the cars off the onboard for a second because apparently you can't hear me, so we'll try and sort that one out for you. Okay, we should be slightly louder now. Hopefully that's not too loud, if you could just let us know if that's okay. As the traffic gets unbelievable and Ryan Gilmore gets caught out by that, unfortunately. Kicks him into the wall and a huge crash behind, actually. This is insane. If you think this is bad, this is only the qualifying session, so... But there's cars everywhere, this is madness. So we're just going to try and follow someone else at the moment. Again, apologies for the intermittent commentary, there's just some issues we're trying to get sorted. This is the first broadcast of 2013, and unfortunately, myself and Liam have been landed with the job of sorting it out. Liam's still having some issues with his broadcast, unfortunately. As Gaxella, once again, is improving on his lap time. In fact, he's improving on the current pole man, Yael Tien, who's gone fastest, but I don't think that's going to last for much longer. Gaxella comes around the final few corners now. Try on board again, see if you can hear us still. The cars are so loud, actually, for such small engines. And Gaxella, a lot of traffic in front. You can see that building up. And they have been stacking up quite badly through the final corner for the last few laps. Gaxella comes through the final corner onto the main straight now. Heading down. He's getting a nice slipstream, actually, from the car in front. And he will probably take his pole position back. He does indeed with a 37.303, 2/10 faster. He did lose some time in that final sector, perhaps slightly distracted by the traffic. But that means that Yael Tien is now second on the grid. Kevin Westphal has gone to third position for the Logix Razor Motorsports team. A great lap from Kevin there. He's in third position now as Gaxella gets caught in the traffic. Here comes Kevin through sector two. He's four tenths down in his current time. Teammate Zerka in fourth position. So the two Logix teams, definitely the most competitive at the moment, up in third and fourth position. Juan Lopez in fifth position, coming through the second sector beam now. New name to me, I'm not quite sure I've heard of him before. Apologies if you do know who I am or I know who you are, but at the moment I can't quite recall where I've seen you before. He's for Velocity Racing, who are up in 5th position at the moment, coming around the final sector. All the track available. And we will give you a full grid rundown, obviously, at the end of this session, which is actually approaching very fastly in 44 seconds. Yael Tien is coming around to start his final hot lap. So we'll keep tabs on that. He's currently in a lot of traffic though, so he's going to struggle to find a gap here to improve his lap time. I don't think Lopez is going to improve on this run. No, he is not. We'll switch to Gilmore, who's in 6th position. He's coming up to sector 2. Not quite sure he's on a hot lap. Nope, not at the moment, I don't think. Quite a few guys out there struggling to find. We'll try and watch Yael Tien. Yael Tien is the next man who can really threaten his pole position, the all-important pole position, as he comes across the start-finish line to start his hot lap, diving into turn 1. Got to find 2 or 3 tenths to get onto pole, even slightly deeper to turn 1 there. That's cost him already. That's going to compromise his sector 1 time. Gaxella is also out on circuit in the background, trying for a clear lap now. He's basically had a lap to ease off. And he gets turn 1 beautifully in the background, so we'll maybe switch to Gaxella in a second. And the game's gone again, unfortunately. So it looks like, unfortunately, tonight we won't get a broadcast because a lot of issues with this, unfortunately. Hopefully we're back shortly.
Hello everybody and welcome back. Sorry for the problems we've had so far. You join us now in this warm-up session. You can see a little bit of carnage on the circuit, but we're back in the warm-up after the qualifying results have come in. So my name is Liam Jenkins. With me is Lee Morrison. Lee, already in qualifying, we've seen a very trafficable grid, to say the least. There's been every car scrounging around to try and find a lap time. And now they've finally got some space in warm-up. How do you approach this session? It's been a very tense session. Do you take this chance to try and cool down and just get yourself in the zone for the race? Or do you just try and go out and try and do the best you can in that hot lap in the car so you feel most comfortable?
So just trying to sort a few issues out still. Hopefully you can see everything fine, and apologies again for the issues, like as there is still sheer carnage going on track. But well, a lot of people have had some problems in this so far. There have been a lot of people who have been disrupting in qualifying, so it's very difficult now for them people to keep their head and, you know, really try and knuckle down.
Yeah, especially for guys perhaps who are in the top five, definitely hunting for a victory or maybe finish a little bit lower than they would have expected. Their mental game needs to be at its absolute finest, and if you've got issues like this and the game keeps disconnecting, it can be so hard to try and keep your head held high and keep that motivation level as it once was. So hopefully all the drivers can do a good job of this. And Lee, I mean, you've driven this track countless times now. Just how much of a challenge is Melbourne to the drivers?
It's gone again. Sorry guys, going to be no broadcast tonight, unfortunately, because this just won't work. Apologies for that. Alright, it is live.
Hello everybody and welcome back. We're going to try one more time for you. We're determined to try and get this broadcast up and running, and hopefully we'll get to see some racing action soon. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the format of this event, I think it'll be now a good opportunity to try and run through. So as you can see, the weather's looking a bit on and off at the moment. There's dark clouds in the sky and a looming threat of rain, which could very heavily impact the racing. So the racing is 15 laps, so it's definitely going to be a lot of action. And of course, don't forget, after that is a double race. So you've got another race straight after, meaning that if you maybe crash out the first race or things don't quite go your way, you've always got an opportunity to redeem yourself. And Lee, with a field this big, I think that could be a saving grace for some of these drivers.
Yeah, at the moment it's anyone's game, so I mean, we're having so many issues here, aren't we? So God knows what the other drivers are going through.
Yeah, it must be safe for straightening for them as well, I think, and they're just going to get back out on the circuit, and then there's a little technical problem, or the server goes down, or something like that, and it really can affect your mindset, because as these drivers, I mean, whether you know them as people, or just people you're watching in the broadcast, they are so focused, so single-minded on winning and getting the absolute best out of that car. And as soon as your mind gets unsettled, or something just untakes you, or takes your concentration for just a few seconds, it takes so long to try and get settled back in again. And especially when you're just waiting for so long for this session to clock over and get into the race, as I believe we have now. So we just wait for the cars to get on the grid. We will have a formation lap, so a chance to go through. As there you can see, your pole sitter, Gazella, so we'll see what he can do from the pole position. There are the qualifying standings at the moment. You've got Tajin P2, Westphal P3, Zerk is in P4, Jack Nichols there, P9, and if Jack can race as well as he commentates, I wouldn't be surprised to see him charge through the field sooner than we think. But more importantly, Lee, the sun is out at the moment.
Yeah, I just warn the viewers, don't get too comfortable, because I'm just trying to do what I can at the moment to stop you from crashing, but as is people behind the scene. And the formation laps go anyway, so
So we'll try and get as much of this action in as we can for you guys. Again, apologies from all of us here at GPVWC. We've been experiencing problems all night long, so hopefully this is the end of them and the start of something new to tie in with the start of the new season. The question is, who's going to be crossing that finish line for the first time in first position? So making sure everything's up to temperature in that car now. And more importantly, just make sure that you don't make a mistake on this formation lap, because it's so easy to do. The tyres are cold, the brakes are cold. If you just go offline slightly, or the brakes aren't quite there, you can so easily lose the car off the circuit or gently tap a barrier. And we've seen it so many times before, so just got to be very focused now and don't try anything too drastic or get too overboard with yourself. And just know what you can do in the car. Just feel comfortable. Due to an extent, you'll see some drivers weaving about the track frantically, trying to get some heat into the tyres. You'll see others just driving the racing line and making sure they get to the start-finish line, because at the end of the day, you've got to be in it to win it. So they're coming towards the end of the first sector now, and then down possibly one of the most fantastic overtaking opportunities on the circuit, down this long curve straight. Now you're going to see so much slipstreaming down here throughout the entire race, and of course the second one as well. So it's really just going to be a case of, can you get that move on the inside though, because it's such a tricky corner to overtake under, but we should have to see what these drivers can do. And Lee, I mean, as I said before, you've driven this circuit countless times. Where do you think is probably the best overtaking opportunity for these drivers?
Well, again, apologies for my intermittent commentary, just trying to sort through a few things, but Australia is a very difficult track to pass on, because the top speeds don't get too high, so you don't really get much chance to get a slipstream. As you said, the back straight, it's a good opportunity in some respects if you can get alongside off the corner, but it's very difficult to make the passing manoeuvre into the fast left-right chicane. The best place pretty much is down into turn one, but again, you've got to be alongside off the exit of the corner now, as you see Gaxella coming round. So they're going to take a long time to form up here anyway, as you can see Tien in the background going crazy trying to get heat into his tyres. It's going to be crucial with this new weather plug-in. The temperatures are so critical on the tyres.
And that's why you can see the field just slowly trying to stroll to the line. It's very clever strategy there by Gixella. Not going to the line because he has to, because once he stops, you've got to wait for nearly 30 other drivers to get to their grid slots, and that's going to take some time. And by the time they'll get there, those tyres are going to be so cold again, and all that hard work is going to be lost. So you can just wait for the final drivers to line up on the grid, and then those four red lights to get this season underway.
Yeah, just hoping if we can get through turn one okay, we might be able to get a broadcast going, because I think that's going to be the most difficult phase. And that probably applies to the rest of the field as well. As you see the last cars coming into position, I'll let you take it, Liam.
So, all of the... Oh, there's been a little bit of a shunt.
Yeah, in the background. Who's that? Someone in the background's hit Not quite sure who it is. There's someone on wet tyres at the back of the grid. What I can see, which is Andy Smith seems to be on the wet compound tyre. I don't think the race will get started at the moment. It seems to be Ron Squire, Simon Mellowish has had some issues as well at the back. They're all, how on earth can you crash into the back of someone off the formation lap? But are they in position now? It's Hillard who's out of position. Hillard has been hit at the rear, he's got no rear wing and he's out of position. And I think that's causing, I know that the race is going ahead. I think Hillard's left the grid. So Liam, take it away.
So all the tension is about to become let loose around this Melbourne Park circuit. We've got four red lights and there's a bit of a jump start at the back, but we're away and Gixxella leads the field in towards that first corner for the first time this season as the field just stream into turn one like a pack of hungry dogs. Let's just hope they can all make it through okay. Gixxella has got through perfectly there and got the great jump on the man in second. The rest of the field been left for dust pretty much behind. Hopefully not too much contact has occurred, but the two leaders have got a fantastic start.
Big crash in the background, big accident in the background, huge accident in the background. Never seen anything like that before on our factor. That's, you see there, a little bit of commotion. There's cars piling into each other. There's at least, God, look at that there. Look at how many cars on the track.
Oh my goodness.
It's insane. There were cars going through the air. That's madness. I don't see how many cars are out. There's only two cars retired at the moment, but a lot of cars with some serious damage. The two leaders have pulled an absolutely stonking gap in the first few corners. I mean, they just avoided the carnage, and it's Gixxella and Tian up front.
Indeed, and
Lopez and Vest fell off as well. This is going to be, I've got to expect a restart here or something, because Vest fell, and they've come back into the park, and there's cars going off again. Maybe a restart or something, but there's cars off everywhere at the moment.
A one-man praying there won't be one is Gixxella. He's got a massive lead now over Zerka, who's had a great start into P2. So Gixxella's just going to try and keep his head focused now and try and pull away. 2.4 seconds of gap currently back to the man in second place. And you can see it's going to be very comforting for him. But knowing at least half the field have been involved in some sort of minor contact, they can see Coriala in P5 coming under pressure in that Storm Racing now P6. A textbook move there going in towards one of the final corners as they stream through once again. But for the most part, though, the rest of the field managing to make their way through relatively cleanly that we've seen and trying to avoid the carnage. It's always the best bet. Don't go for anything too aggressive in the opening laps. But are we going to see maybe a rebound here? He gets a great run off the final corner and looks to the inside. No, he can't get enough momentum as they cross the start finish line now. Let's see what he can do. Niemanen's going to be under pressure into turn one. Coriala looks to the inside, thinks better of it. Too early in the race to risk that when you've only had one lap. You've got 14 more to go.
Jack Nicklaus going on the inside there of Adrian McNaughton. So Jack Nicklaus makes that move sticky to turn one, and a few guys made a move into turn one there. And surprisingly, after all the carnage, only four cars out. We've got Mellerish out, Fontana out, McCluskey out, and we have Khan, who I'm not sure, but someone's starting on the hard tyres. I think it's Andy Smith in 34th position. And someone's off in the background. Who was that? There's cars off everywhere. Again.
So again, frustration ensues for a lot of these drivers, but one man who's not in 2-4 right now is Gixxella, 2.5 seconds in front of Zerka as they come towards around halfway around the second lap. But Nichols, as you saw, great pass into turn one, getting himself back up into P9. He's got a few seconds away though behind the man in P8. We've got some side-by-side action there. That is Lee Palmer going around the outside for P7, trying to hold that for as long as he can right now.
Yeah, he's just taken Eric Tivette there for that seventh position. Lee Palmer moves up there. He was very quick in the practice section, actually. Tian's been very scruffy in this opening few laps. He was second position, as you saw, and he lost a lot of time in the first lap. He made a huge mistake through the fast left right. He's just made another one and dropped from another second or so, and Zerka is pulling away now and starting to catch Gixxella, actually. So Zerka is actually he's actually catching Gixxella, has the pace to catch him. Looking back through the field to see if there's any more big battles going on. The big scraps at the moment are all in the midfield, but wow, look at that. From P15, we'll quickly have a look at this. P15 is a big gaggle of cars behind them. We do still have 35 cars running in this race, as you see. And Zerka does set the fastest lap, as I said. He's catching Gixxella pretty quickly at the moment, actually.
Yeah, and a massive train of cars, as you said as well. And it's so complicated to not get yourself tied up in an incident right now, but these guys are managing to do so pretty well as they'll come over that start finish once again. One of the Optima Motorsports cars just up in front. There's Mike Bell, I believe, that's coming. Oh, he's off the circuit. Running, he's got himself back on. Not going to be too much of a damper on the race so far for him, but the rest of the drivers are trying to make sure they don't repeat the same instance as the car off in the background, very conveniently parked off the circuit. So I'm assuming that was from an earlier incident. But it's looking pretty good right now for Gixxella, but as we said, he is being caught. 3 tenths taken out of him last time round. If he keeps that up, he will be caught in no time. We're going to see an almighty battle for the lead on our hands. But talking of almighty battles, this is just crazy right now.
Yeah, Jack Nicholls also got McNaughton coming back at him now. Jack Nicholls, we saw him make that great move into turn one. McNaughton now coming down the inside and he makes the move stick. Will he get the car stopped? He will, just about, runs slightly deep. Oh, a bit of contact there, but Jack takes the position back, keeps ahead and takes the position in the background. You can see there Jan Schwitter with Juan Lopez right behind him. And they're going to go side by side into the fast left right, which isn't going to be fun. And there is contact, but they sort it out between them. So some real close racing in this midfield.
Oh, indeed. Let's see what these guys can do through here then. He's going to try and look around the outside now. It's a very tricky move to try and commit to. It's going to be very tightly squeezed. Oh, right back up the inside. And there was just no time to react to that one at all. Position taken, sign sealed, delivered. But for how long? Because now it comes into that very tricky penultimate corner. And of course, the final one, we can get such a good run coming down that home straight. So let's see what McNaughton can do here then. They're coming, oh, gets a little bit wide there. But Nicholls bit right back there, not taking any prisoners here as he comes across the start-finish line.
Yeah, Coriala in the pits. I think he's lost his front wing. Coriala was one of the front runners. He was in fifth or sixth position. He's lost his front wing. He's in the pit lane now. I tried to keep tabs on the leaders while we're watching this battle as Ryan Gilmore is closing on Jarl Tiem for fourth, Tvedt in sixth position. We'll get back to the battle for seventh. For McNaughton trying to go around the outside of Nicholls, and he's going to do it. He's going to do it, and he's done it. What a great move from Adrian McNaughton there. Really great move in the Storm Racing team. Just quickly run down, Liam. We've got Gexella leading from Benjamin Zirka. In fact, Jarl Tiem's just taken it because Zirka's been off. Zirka's just been off the track, and he's now in fourth position. We're going to switch to him. Zirka's just made a mistake coming through the complex section under the trees. I think he ran too wide onto the gravel, and that's cost him two positions. So it's now Gexella from Tiem, Gilmore. Gilmore in third position. A great comeback. Zirka, Nijmegen in 5th, Tvedt 6th, McNaughton 7th, Jack Nicholls 8th, Juan Lopez 9th, and running at the top of the moment is Jan Schwitter.
So what happened to Adrian McNaughton now then? He's obviously had some sort of minor incident, and there you can see Gilmore's got himself right up there into P3, so he's looking very comfortable right now. But Zirka's got to try and recuperate, hasn't he? Because it's so easy once you make a mistake like that, and more importantly, you lose a couple of positions from when you're up at the top of the field. It's so hard to recuperate and get those positions back. So we'll see how we can try and recover from that. As you can see, Gilmore in third position with Simic Motorsport at the moment. Gets a little bit wobbly out of that penultimate corner, but that's not going to provide too much of an advantage for Zirka just behind as they cross the line for the end of lap number four. Still Gaxella in the lead though.
Yeah, Tvedt in sixth position. He's got a gaggle of cars behind him now. You can see that is in the background. Adrian McNaughton, Jack Nicholls, and Juan Lopez is right on the back of this actually. And you can see in the background Juan Lopez looking to make a move on Jack Nicholls. Don't know if he's got the slipstream down. And in the background from there, actually, you can see that's Jan Schwitter and Matt Klipp. Matt Klipp and something's happened to Schwitter there. We'll quickly switch back from that. I think he's lagged out, unfortunately. He was having a great race. And I think he's lagged out, unfortunately, there. So Matt Klipp keeps that 10th position for the moment.
Yeah, now look at the gap between Gaxella and Tia now, purely because of Zirka's demise, if you will, shortly off the circuit. 5 second comfort zone, but back in this colossal battle involving Adrian McNaughton trying to push towards P6. He's got Nicholls, who's right in front of him there. To Vite, though, is coming under pressure in Ice Cold Racing. Talking to Vite before this weekend, looking very confident in Ice Cold, but we have to see what he can do. He's coming under intense pressure right now. Eric Only Young, and a very hot contender in the Touring Pro Series. We'll see if he can bring his talents to the open wheelers. And it's got to be said, he's putting on a fine display in the opening laps.
Yeah, at the moment, Gaxella's got his own way up front, and he's 5, nearly 6 second gap up front. But this is going to end in tears if you try and go side by side through here. We've seen this before, and there was contact, but these two are much more sensible. Tvedt now runs deep in the corner. This will give McNaughton the run off the corner. It does indeed, but look in the background as well. The other two are scrapping, but Tvedt going to the inside once again to defend. We'll switch to the TV camera and have a look at this. Will he try it right on the outside? He's done it before. He tries it again. No, he has to back out. But look at Nicholls now. Nicholls come back up the inside. That's great opportunistic driving there from Jack Nicholls. Jack Nicholls saw that coming. He waited, pounced at the last minute, and he's taken one car in one move. And Juan Lopez now trying to get past McNaughton. So McNaughton from being on the offensive, but Tvedt goes off the track. This is going to can Nicholls take two cars in two corners? We're going to go on board with him down the main street. He needs to get back in the slipstream. Go back in there, Jack. That's it. Back in the slipstream. But Tvedt's got some. Look at that straight line speed from Tvedt. That's why he's defending. But look in the background. That's Tvedt. Is that McNaughton coming back again? McNaughton's going to try and go down the outside. This is going to be fun into turn one. And there's a bit of contact, but they managed to get through okay. And Juan Lopez trying to take advantage around the outside. This is madness, sheer madness. Looking back, that's Nicholls. We're looking back at McNaughton. And in fact, I'm not quite sure who's anyone anymore. They're all side by side. There's a bit of contact there as they go into the corner. I'll let you take it from here, Liam, because it's getting a bit too crazy for me.
Yeah, so these cars battling like crazy right now. You just simply cannot put anything between these guys. They're leaving it all out on the tarmac. Nichols provisionally got the better of the two behind him. But you can see just him in front. Eric Tveit, we have a little smile on his face because he's leaving that trio for dust. He tries to pull away into the sunset, but he is being chased down by three hungry drivers who all want that desperate point in his opening race. There you can see McNaughton trying around the outside now. That's very risky through there. He won't have momentum. Watch out for Lopez, who's got to push McNaughton through. Nichols immediately defends, almost a bit of contact there. Lopez very almost thinking off his front wing, but just about holds on to it. But McNaughton, more importantly, takes that position once again. So these guys have been trading positions frantically here today.
Yeah, this is the best action on the track at the moment. There's some great battles going on for the midfield, but this is the best action on the track as Nichols once again having to defend. Lopez is up the inside though. Lopez, one, has got the move made. He goes in. He doesn't go in too deep. Will Nichols do the switchback again? He's done it a few times. Gaxella sets the fastest lap of the race. That's no surprise. Oh, and McNaughton comes back up the inside again. Sorry, Nichols comes back up the inside again. This is crazy racing, and Juan Lopez sticks it down the inside again. There's going to be contact again, and look at Tveit now. He's on his own. Well, he's got McNaughton all over the back of him as well, so we'll quickly switch to this. McNaughton, we're on board with McNaughton now. Got a great slipstream coming down to turn one. We're behind Tveit. We now switch to the TV camera. McNaughton's got the inside, the side by side coming into turn one, and McNaughton's got the position. Tveit can't do anything to defend against that, but we saw Tveit have great straight line speed, and he's back in the slipstream now. So watch out for Tveit down into turn three here. He's gonna, no, he hasn't closed up quick enough, has he?
No, not quite, but McNaughton has been on an absolute massive charge. You can see once again Lopez and Nichols side by side, and they're both
and
on the circuit.
Yeah.
And I wonder if Clip's going to be able to come back, but no, he's not. Nichols retains his position. Watch out for Clip, and now it's a door slammed shut there by Lopez, who's trying to defend that with his life. He's not going to let anyone through without some sort of fight. As you can see, Joseph P13 trying to hold on right there. As that battle for 15th is still looking very feisty. The car separated out into two groups of three, it seems. You can see Yukonen, I believe, in holding that P12 at the moment. But, oh, this is frantic. There's cars battling all over the circuit right now. It's a racing fan's dream, but possibly a racing driver's nightmare if you're new to this series, because this is very tense stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I don't actually have any idea who half the drivers are overtaking each other. It's just that mad. I mean, they've come from nowhere, some of the drivers. Just a quick shout out to a few people who are watching. We have there's Jason Kershaw who's tuned in to watch as well. There's a couple of people on my Facebook wall have mentioned it as well. Bjorn Strosen, I hope I've said your name correctly. And the Leprechauns are certainly on the track today, as you've mentioned. Dimitri Bulmeister and Steve Verloy. Verloy is also watching the broadcast, obviously a Super League driver himself. There's a few more people watching as well, apparently, so hopefully you're enjoying the action and the track. It's pretty hard to keep up with, and we'll try and get back to it as soon as we can. Gaxella, though, extending his lead up front pretty comfortably at the moment from Tiernan Gilmore, second and third, Nyman and fourth. Nyman and fourth has got Zirko over the back of him, actually. We'll quickly switch to this. Zirko making a comeback. In fact, has he been off the track again, actually?
He may have been. He's down to P5 as Nieminen is up into P4, but they're only separated by around 3/10 of a second. To Zirka, as I said before, though, once he's made that mistake, you're always prone to make more because it's just on your mind playing all the time. The same corner, it wouldn't surprise me if he's had another minor incident through there, but he is still just inside the top five at the moment. But he's got to try and get his head in the right place, find some pace under that car, which you know he has, and push himself back up the field.
Yeah, we saw this last year from the Logics guys, didn't we? I mean, it was... last year it was David Gaspers and Zirka in the team, and they would often dominate the qualifying session first and second by a surprisingly large margin. And then when we get to the race, their mistakes would kick in, and Jarl Tiernan in second position getting very wide again through the fast left and right. He's trying to close down Gaxella, but it's not happening at the moment. Yeah, then we'd see the Logics guys make some mistakes during the race and lose the... I mean, I remember in one of the races last year, I think it was the Brazilian Formula Challenge race, they took each other out while first and second. So, I mean, it was quite unlucky, but it's just one of the things that sort of plagued their season. I mean, they're very quick, but let's hope they can sort these mistakes out during the race, because it's costing them some good results.
Yeah, they've hit the nail on the head there, so let's see what Zirka can do, and are the winds of change blowing for them around Albert Park? There's only one way to find out as we get ready towards to go in towards the second half of this race. You can see Gixella's crossed the line, 7.4 seconds now, the lead between himself and the man in second place. Gilmore's there in third. We've got a triumphant battle here as well. The P17, I believe that's one of the Ice Cold guys straight up the inside there, and that's Scott battling away with Hermsey. So let's see what can go on here between these guys. Only separated by a little bit, but that's still in the battle for 15th position. I believe it's one of the Optimum Sim Racing guys as well, just behind there. We'll have to see what can happen between these guys. But you've got to be so careful as well, especially when you're at the back of one of those battles. You just focus in on what the car in front of you is doing, as he's got a much better run coming out of the final corner. Darts to the inside, and that should be done before the corners even arrive. And Scott Cervic moves up into P16. No, P17, I beg your pardon. But back
into
this
now. Yes, Juan Lopez, sorry Liam, Juan Lopez trying to get past him. Juan Lopez is really impressing me actually in this. He's been very quick and very calm and collected so far. He's made some great overtaking manoeuvres, and at the moment he's looking to take another big scalp in Eric Tivette, who we know, as you mentioned before, he's very quick. The problem is once he gets past Tivette, there's McNaughton 3 seconds down the road. There's a huge, huge gap to the Zirka and Nijmegen battle, which we'll try and get back to any second if they hot up. But at the moment this is the closest battle on track, as one of the backmarkers tries to get out of the way there. That is Chris Williamson just getting out of the way nicely there of this battle, so he doesn't interrupt. Like Juan Lopez, I'm sure he's sensible enough not to try and move into this chicane because it's insane. And he does, he sets it up for the exit quite nicely, gets on the curb in a bit though, and in the background that's Jack Nicklaus coming back at them. So Jack Nicklaus coming back from actually being passed by both of them. Gatchala sets the fastest lap once again on a 1:38.0, which is an amazingly fast time in the race.
Yeah, and it's going to be working out quite well for Nicklaus now, because he's currently in a popcorn-esque position, as I like to refer to it. He just got to watch this battle and wait for the inevitable mistake to come.
It's starting to rain, sorry, Liam, it's starting to rain. The rain's coming down.
What a curveball that is for the drivers. I wonder who's going to pit in. Nicklaus gets a much better run out of the final corner, so let's see if he can maybe take two cars in two corners. Right now, though, it's not going to be looking too good there, as Tivite, looking to bite right back into the first corner, straight up the inside, but the car's twitching, the rain's getting under the tyres, he's gone a little bit off the circuit there. Surely, it's all about strategy now. Do you pit in, do you risk it to try and get a jump on your fellow opponent? As Nicklaus tries for the comeback, he's nowhere near close enough, but this is going to be very handy now for Lopez, who's now been able to just breeze away into the distance, because now not only have Tivite and Nicklaus got to keep their cars on the circuit in a tricky condition, they've also got to be wary of each other because they're in a battle, as are Zirka and Nijmegen right now.
Well, at the moment, if it keeps like this, I mean, it's stopped raining now from what I can see. I think it's only raining on parts of the circuit. I mean, we're coming down the back straight now with Zirka and Nijmegen, and I can't see any rain whatsoever. And plus, we saw Gaxelis at the fastest lap last time round, so obviously the weather's not affecting him too much. I mean, he's got a good lead now as well, so he can really be comfortable. And I don't think he'd pit at the moment. There's no rain on the circuit in the in fact the final sector's dry again as well now, so not quite sure if that was just a brief intermittent shower, but at the moment it's holding off.
As you'll see for how long, we still have 6 laps remaining, as you can see at the top of your screens at the moment. If you've just tuned in, where have you been? You missed some of the most fantastic action we've seen here. So you tune in right now. This is Eric Tivite still holding that position from Nicklaus at the moment. But I wonder for how much more these two again been engaged. And it's got to be said, Jack Nicklaus, since his starting position, has been in every position around between 9 and P6, hasn't he, really? He's been jostling very hard with a lot of the opponents today, providing some exciting action. Let's see what he can do coming out of the final corner. Can he get a better run from Tivite again? And he has indeed. He's latched onto the back of him, looks to the inside straight away. Is not quite there yet as they come across the start-finish line. They can see Clip just behind them in P10 as well. Tivite gets a much better braking point into turn one. And I wonder, though, how long can these guys hold off before another move occurs? Because Nicklaus is just braking a lot earlier and trying to get a much better drive out of the corners. It may have worked as he looks to the inside here. Has he got enough momentum? We're about to find out. He's going to have to brake a lot later. Tivite cuts him off very nicely there and holds his ground for a little longer.
Yeah, he's trying to go around the outside now. He's trying to set it up for the next right-hander, which is a very dangerous move. He's keeping his foot in his jack, but he has to... well, look at Matt Clip in the background. Matt Clip's got a tremendous run while these two are battling. He's on the outside now of Nicklaus, trying to take the position. And don't do anything silly, Matt. I was just about to give Matt Clip a shout-out because he's doing a superb job so far in his race. A really great job. And what's happened? Someone... Ryan Gilmore's spun. So maybe it is getting wet out there, because Ryan Gilmore's spun and he's now down to fifth position, and he's spun and latched round to the back of the Zirka Nijmegen battle. So that's a change of position. I'm not sure it's the conditions though, because Gaxella was only 4 tenths slower on his previous lap. PM was a good 2 seconds slower, so it affected people in different ways. But certainly that's some change there.
I wonder
and
if
it is raining. It's raining extremely heavily, that's why it's raining so heavily. Look at it. You can see the rain coming down. I'm not quite sure if you can see it on your screens, but the rain is falling. The spray coming from the tyres. Gaxella goes through. His lap was only 6 tenths slow, but I'm sure it'll be slower this time round. We've got a tremendous battle for fourth position now between Zirka Gilmore and Nijmegen. But in the background, it's once again Eric Tivette under pressure from the ever-present Jack Nicklaus. And look at the wet. You can see how wet the track is. You can see the entrails from the cars now as well. Oh, and Tivette gets a tremendous slide on there. So now this is going to play into certain people's hands who ran more downforce.
And I wonder as well, it's all going to be a battle of nerves right now. We try and wait to see who's going to be the winner of this short battle. Tavite seems to have got Jack Nicholas' number going in towards the first corner. But now, as I said, it's a battle of nerves. And more importantly, calling the other opponent's bluff, because obviously you want to try and get the jump on your opponents in the pit lane. Do you think it's going to carry on raining? Do you go for those intermediate tyres? Or do you risk it? Feel comfortable on the dryers and maybe just try and hold off. But look at this right now. Niemann in third. You've got just behind them, I believe that's Gilmore. So you've got Zerka there as well, still up to P4 after Gilmore's spin. So these three cars all together nicely after getting themselves past a lapped car. But it's going to be very interesting. Who do you think so going to dive in? Well, what would you do in this situation, Lee? Say you're in about P5, P6. You're in a nice battle with another car, just as Zerka and Gilmore are right now. And it's starting to rain. Do you pit in for tyres and risk it? Or do you just try and keep your car on the circuit and take an even bigger risk?
Well, at the moment, it's stopped raining again. So, at the moment, I mean, Matt Clip's also trying to have a go to Jack Nicholas, and Matt Clip got past Jack Nicholas. So the track is wet, and I'm just waiting for Gaxella's lap time. Considering last time round, he did a 38.6. I'd expect this to be somewhere in the 40s, maybe. I mean, 42. So 4 seconds off the race pace he was setting earlier. So it has definitely, the rain definitely has wet the track a little bit, and it's affected some guys. As you saw, and Gilmore has lost his front wing. So Ryan Gilmore has lost his front wing. So from a great drive, he's now got no front wing. But he may as well keep going, because he's got a huge gap behind. And you might still be able to hold on to fifth position, well, sixth position at least, maybe. You've got Juan Lopez a good, 16 seconds behind him, so. And there's cars spinning everywhere, so this is really difficult conditions for everyone now. As you can see, there's fields split up slightly, but Gaxella, building the gap early on, this is playing to his hands perfectly, because he can just sit back and relax now.
Indeed, and you can see the rest of the field coming across the start finish line once again. Only 3 laps to go here. Matt Clip up to P9. A great drive by him, it's got to be said. Now he's got his way past Jack Nicholas. Can he put... And there's a rear wing now that may have been Gilmore's, I think, off at turn one.
And not quite sure what that is. It's none of the front runners, that's for sure. The front runners, the only front runner who has lost any wing is Gilmore. I think it's some rear tail enders, unfortunately. We've still only had a few retirements. There's still 30 cars going around in this race. Not quite sure who's losing the wings at the moment. It's Chris Parr in 27th position, who's lost his front wing and rear wing at turn one, so obviously he's struggling with the conditions.
Yeah, the rest of the drivers seeming to manage them quite nicely now. And do you call your opponent's bluff, or it's going to be interesting to see if any of these top 10 decides to risk it and go for intermediate tyres. But at this stage in the race, we're only a few laps to go. By the time the tyres get up to heat, surely the advantage would have disappeared.
Yeah, the track's almost dragging now. We're watching Gaxella. Well, we're not watching Gaxella. I'm watching Gaxella's lap times at the moment, but you're just looking at this four-way scrap, which has gone from now Matt Clip in 8th position, Jack Nicholas, Eric Tivet and Hoekstra. Tivet's gone backwards in this in some respects. This time round, Gaxella at 40.2, so 2 seconds faster than the previous lap. So the track is almost dry again, really. It was just a light shower that caused a bit of havoc there. And unfortunately, that worked out worse for Ryan Gilmore, because he's losing a lot of time without that front wing, and I don't think he's going to be able to stay in the top 10, unfortunately. He's lost a good 12 seconds on this lap, I think. But this battle continues to rage. In the background, you can see Hoekstra getting... Is that Hoekstra getting past? It is. Hoekstra's just past Tivet. Has Tivet got some issues? Yes, Tivet's lost his front wing. I'm not quite sure where that happened. We missed that on the screen. Tivet lost his front wing, obviously battling with the four-way scrap, and that's caused some problems with him. Further behind that, you've got, in 13th position, Mikko Jakkinen and Mike Skroton. Trying to switch to now. They've just been battling through the fast left and right as well. So there's battles all around the track.
Yeah, and going towards the final corner, let's see. I mean, it's great to see those clouds once again looking a bit bluer than before. The track's drying out, and I'm sure some of the drivers will feel a bit comforted that they didn't pit in for tyres. But it's just a great plug-in, I think. I've got to thank the guys at GPVWC for including this. It's made the racing very exciting, as you can see. Just as we say that, that was almost a lot more exciting than it could have been, as he loses the position. But nonetheless, he'll keep pushing forward now as Jakkinen, and just try and keep the car on the circuit. Only 2 laps to go. The pressure's not on now. If I was him, you know, he's got a massive distance between himself and the car behind. Just keep the car on the circuit and keep for the position where you are. But Gaxella's shown no signs of that at all, has he? He's led from pole position here, and he's got a 10.2 second lead over Tiernan.
Yeah, he's been absolutely flawless, hasn't he? He's not made one mistake. He's basically just got out and drove the conditions, whatever they are, which has been pretty good, actually. But Jack Nicholas is trying to have a go at Matt Clip in 8th position. I hope these two can keep this clean. And Jack's got the inside. This is going to be... Will he go for it? He does. He keeps his foot in. So very brave driving there from Jack Nicholas. And it pays off this time. Matt Clip, can he respond? Matt Clip has really impressed me in this race, actually, up in the 9th position now. Battling with people like Tivet, Clip and Hoekstra, Gilmore. Well, in fact, these two will move up a position anyway, because Gilmore, I don't think he'll be able to hold them off in the last lap. as we've actually started the last lap. I've got Kinsella, he's on the final lap, and we'll switch to him shortly. We're just going to check out for any last minute battles on the track. Can't really see anything at the moment apart from this one, which seems to be settled now. Fourth position, Zirka and Imanen are very close, but will Nyman have a go? I will make sure we switch back to the leader for you, Liam, across the line, so don't worry about that. It's Nyman in third and Benjamin Zirka fourth at the moment, and Zirka's got a run. Will he have a go?
It's a risky place to do so. Oh, and there's contact! And he goes flying off the road, and a race goes from bad to worse for Zirka. I don't think there's any substantial damage to the car, but it's a nasty knock. Can he lose another position?
He's got
the
McNaughton car gone. McNaughton goes through. Yeah, McNaughton's lost a position.
Yeah, thank you very much, says Adrian McNaughton. And Zirka's race, I mean, in those situations, so it's the final lap of the race, your racing driver instinct takes over and you want to try and get the best position you can. But the racing instinct of this man has been unparalleled. Gexeller has led from pole position. Oh, and a big spin there, almost. And he managed to keep it out of the way of Gexeller. That could have ended traumatically in the closing stages, but Gexeller ignores all the carnage, all of the excitement, and breezes home to a fantastic first victory of the season. Gexeller wins at Albert Park.
Yeah, great drive from Manuel Gexeller there, showing his class once again. He showed us last year how good he can be. Jarl Tian, slightly scruffy drive, takes second position. I think he could have done a bit better than that without the mistakes. Same goes to Zirka as well. Nyman is going to take third. And McNaughton and Zirka in fourth and fifth position. Look, they're very close. And Zirka, look at Zirka's train. Wow, he tried to get the power nearly there. He did have a run, but he's ruined it, unfortunately. And that leaves McNaughton fourth, Zirka fifth. Zirka, you can see, not happy with that. Juan Lopez, big shout out to Juan Lopez in sixth position. But look at the train in seventh position. They've just passed Gilmore. And can Matt Clip take Gilmore as well? Matt Clip trying to get past Gilmore as well in the background. You can just see. Come on, Matt, let's have that seventh position.
Well, Gilmore's doing everything he can to block. Oh, it's going to be close.
And there's going to be contact to go across the line. So it's Nichols, seventh. Gilmore, eighth. Matt Clip, a superb drive to ninth. And Wopke Hoekstra, tenth position. Great job from him as well. Paul Joseph, 11th. And the last few just coming across the line now. Yeah, so we have Mike Scroton takes 12th position. Mikko Jäkkinen slipped back in the end to 13th. Tivet just holds on to 14th with no front wing from Scott Sovic. Rick Scott 16th. Alvin Hermsey takes 17th position. Tim Oliver Wagner he's going to be 18th position. And our final finisher on the lead lap is going to be Rodney van der Zjut in 19th position for Midori Motorsport. I don't think you're looking at it. There you go. He's just coming across the line now for our final finish on the lead lap. The whole rest of the field is finished, which is Lee Palmer in 20th. Duamos Coriala in 21st position, who was up front early on but had a few issues. Kevin Westphal takes 22nd position. Brandon Warren, 23rd. Riku Sarpila, who was very quick last year, actually, in some phases. Disappointed this race. Maybe got caught up in some injuries early on. Thomas Jacobs, 25th. Alex Rolls, John McLean, Chris Parr, Chris Williamson. And our final finisher is Doug Hillard.
Yes, so after all the problems that we've seen here today regarding the broadcast, I'm sure I definitely made up for it with that race, Lee. And I'm sure, I mean, if there's one driver that's definitely stood up to you, who would it be today?
Well, personally, I'll just switch us to the my screen. Personally for me, it was obviously Gaxella was the standout as such in the fact that he just, whatever the conditions threw at him, he took it and just drove the wheels off it. The standout for me was Matt Clip. I think Matt Clip did a great job. He really has improved. People said he'd improved quite a lot, and he's shown it today. He was up there in 8th position, battling with, you know, some really good names, some really top names.
Yeah, I completely agree, Dan. I also think that Lopez did a great job as well to avoid all the carnage, get himself through the battles that we saw earlier with McNaughton, with Jack Nicholls and other drivers. He just got it through safely and picked home some nice points for the team. So we get ready to move for the second qualifying session of the afternoon. Who's your pick going to be? Do you think maybe Gaxella can do it again, Lee?
Well, at the moment, I'm not too sure on the rules, how they're working. I'm not too sure if we get reverse grid again like last time. If that's the case, then it's going to be difficult because we saw the chaos in round one. So we'll have to see what happens on that. I think it is a reverse grid, but only so many. I'm not quite sure. We'll soon find out. Yeah, top 15 will reverse, apparently. So we'll soon find out what's going to happen, but it's going to be a real struggle, I think, because you've seen it's just insane in the midfield, it really is. But that race, it really was worth waiting for in some respects. I know we had some issues and that. They'll be ironed out as the season continues. Obviously, for next race, we hope to have everything sorted, like Liam said. And it should be a lot smoother ride. But that race really was really fun to watch.
Yeah, and for some of those drivers as well, they've been putting in months of practice for this event, making sure their car, the team, is absolutely perfect. And, you know, I mean, yourself, Liam, you've driven at the very top flight here at GPVWC. Just walking, having a teammate duty, I mean, it's all very well going into a season like this solo or just trying to manage your own team and your own car. But what sort of morale does having another teammate around you do?
Well, I mean, it can do wonders. If you're both quick, if you're both on the pace, it can do wonders. If one's struggling, one's not on the pace, it can be quite a problem, because it's sometimes hard to... Obviously, you get inter-team rivalries, things like that heating up. If one guy is really quick, the other's not really quick, it can cause rivalry. If both are happy to be, you know, faster or slower than each other and things like that, and vice versa, then it can be nice sometimes. Sometimes it's difficult, but... you know, working together, I mean, you see the Logics guys work together quite well, and usually they're a similar pace, so they get on quite well, and you just get on with it. But it can be difficult sometimes, but usually, if you've got a good teammate, it's always fun having a good teammate, at least.
Alright, so we're in a little warm-up session now, just for the drivers to cool off after what must have been a very tense 20 minutes or so, because so much was left out in that time. Like, we saw everything in between. We saw crashes, some fantastic overtakes. More importantly, we saw a very clean race from the majority of the field. The racing respect out there was just fantastic, and I think the one moment to prove that which stood out for me was at this very corner here, was when Jack Nicholls and Matt Clip were side by side, and Matt Clip lifted off. He saw that the danger was there, and if he'd held on much longer, there would have been inevitable contact. So he lifted off, gave Jack Nicholls enough space to make the move, and that's just the respect that these guys have for each other. And in a league where you've got plus 30 cars racing every race, that's very imperative, I think.
Yeah, there was a lot of respect. I mean, the early lap, I mean, you can forgive. I mean, it was a 45-car field, I think, going into Turn 1. And it didn't look like there was going to be an accident for a while, did it? It looked quite stable. You know, we got through Turn 1 okay. It was Turn 2, in some respects, that was the issue. And the mid-straight between Turn 1 and Turn 2, there was a huge action. I wish we could have got more of it, because it was... I just switched back casually through the field and looked at the back, and it was just insane. There were cars flying everywhere. There was one car that was at least... it must have been at least 20 foot in the air. It really was insane, the accident behind. But that's going to happen in a 45 car field, and that's the thing. If you qualify up front like Gaxella did, you don't get them issues, do you?
No, and even in that situation, there's still some possibilities, like we saw with Zerka as well. In his race, he was just able to try and bring home a good position, but in that final lap, just a catastrophe did occur. He did bring the car home, of course, but it was a lot lower than he would have liked to, I'm sure.
Yeah, one thing I was just going to say, we've got 7 minutes, actually, until the next race begins. I was going to say, do you want to quickly run down the lineup we have in GPV at the moment? Because we didn't really get a chance to do it before. We could just quickly run through them if you wanted to.
Yeah, sounds absolutely perfect.
Well, I mean, I don't know if you've got the same page open, but we'll start with Storm Racing. The Storm Racing team consists of Emmanuel Gaxella, the man who won the race, and Adrian McNaughton, we saw also featuring quite well in that race. They've got to be one of the favourites for the championships, along with Logics Razor Motorsports, who obviously consist of Benjamin Zerka and Kevin Westphal, who are also up there in the race.
Yeah, then you've got Racing Team Schroten. You've got Chris Williamson and Scott Moore driving, so both of those guys had mixed races, have got to be said, in the first one, so I'll be looking to really try and push on during the second race. Velocity Racing as well. You've got Ollie Woods, Tim Oliver Wagner, and Juan Lopez. And Lopez, as I said before, really stood out for me in that first race. So it could be the man to take that team to glory. We shall have to see during second race.
Yeah, he was good, wasn't he, Juan? He did some really great overtaking, especially around the outside. The next one is Optimum Racing. Scott Sovic and Wupke Hoekstra. Hoekstra having a good race. I think he finished 10th in that first one. So his teammate was a bit unlucky. I think he was 14th, 15th, something like that. Not a bad outing for them. Then we have Simic Motorsports, which consists of Ryan Gilmore and Nadir Khan.
Yeah, Royal Blue Racing, and next up, with team owner and driver of the day from Lee Morris, Mr. Matt Clip, and Paul Joseph as well. So Royal Blue looking to take home a royal finish if all things go their way during the second race. Leo Vaxton Racing is the next team on the list, with Chris Barr and Alex Rolls, and again, they will also be looking for a good result. Now, a team formed in Touring Pro Series is Ice Cold Racing, owned by Eric DeVite, and the drivers there are Eric DeVite and Mike Bell. We saw a lot of Eric DeVite during that first race, defended quite well, held his nerve, but again, wasn't quite the finish he hoped for.
No, he was quite unlucky. He just seemed to go backwards and get involved in battles he didn't need to be in some respects. But then we have Midori Motorsport, we mentioned briefly towards the end of the previous broadcast. Rodney van der Zuurt, who is the primary driver there, and Ricardo Mikluski, who I didn't see much of in that race either, and Shane Burke, also the reserve. Then we have DS Racing. Again, didn't see much of them in the first race. We have Dave Simmons. I think I mentioned him a few times. I think we're actually watching him in practice just a moment ago, actually. And Alejandro Fernandez is also the primary driver in that team.
Yeah, indeed he is. So, on to the next team then, which is Slipstream Racing. And that is owned by Miles Dixon. Just below them, you've got Majeric Racing, which is driven by Maspero, John McLean, and then their driver as well, Riku Sarpila. So as you get further down the list, you'll recognise some names. Some are GPV WC veterans, and some are newcomers to the lead, trying to prove their worth in the Formula Challenge. You've got CCU Grand Prix just underneath them, with Correale. And we saw, quite a lot of Correale in that first race. Timmy Corcala there as well. So if those guys ended up in a battle, that would be quite a tongue twister. We also got William Neron, who is the reserve driver for them.
Yeah, the next one up on the list is Vortex GP, but I don't know if they've got any drivers at the moment, because I didn't see, I don't think I've seen them in the server, to be honest. Could be wrong on that one, but we'll soon find out, I guess. Then one after that, Tanskanen Racing. Now, that name rings a bell, obviously, people will know Tanskanen. And driving for that team is Mikko Jäkkinen. He's the only driver, the sole driver in that team, and as you mentioned earlier about having a teammate, he's going to be feeling pretty lonely at the moment. He did feature in the first race quite a lot. We got a few battles of him in the midfield. Then we have Wouters Automotive. I hope I've said that correctly. We have Calvin Hermsey, who we did see a bit of in the first race, and Mike Scroton.
And the next team up on the list is Squire Motorsports from Wales, driven by Ron Squire, and also the man who finished second place in the first race, Jarl Tayen. So he'll be hoping for much of the same success during the second race. Then we've got Viking Racing, driven by Lee Palmer, who again had a very strong race, it seemed, in the opening stint. And Fabio Fontana rounds out the driver lineup from Denmark.
He does. United Racers Motorsports, a team that are familiar with a lot of people now, I think, because Ihab Abbas is the team manager, and he also raced in this series last year. He doesn't race currently, though. His drivers are Thomas Jacobs, who we did see quite a bit of, Cameron Brewster, the reserve, and Simon Miller, which primary was taken out early on, unfortunately, I think. We have Kajala Racing, which is just Ari Nyman, who did feature quite prominently in that race, actually, often battling in the third, fourth, and fifth positions. So he's looking strong, as he did last year when he drove for Torrent Motorsports.
Yeah, next up on the list is JRT, driven by celebrity commentator Jack Nicholls. So, of course, he's raced here for several seasons now in the GPV WC. And again, he put on a fine display showing that he can't just commentate. He's also a very successful driver, it seems. He's got every bit of instinct there to get himself a good result. And also, Rick Scott will partner him alongside in JRT. Antec Racing from Germany are the next team up, driven by Sven Schubert and Jan Schwitter. And they'll be hoping for a much better race, I think, in the second race this afternoon.
Yeah, and the last two teams in this monster lineup we have in the Formula Challenge this year. It was big last year, it's unbelievable this year. Rapid Raptor Racing is at Brandon Warren, he's the sole driver and team manager. And then the same for Falcon GP, Josh Gibson not only leads the team, he also drives in the primary slot. So that covers the entire field, and that took 6 minutes to get through, so you can see why we were struggling to keep up with the field in the first race.
Yeah, so plenty of drivers, and also that can make for a very exciting race, as we saw in the opening one. But more importantly, that first corner is going to be ever more vital to get yourself through cleanly now, because some of the top 15, as we said, are completely reversed, which means that it's going to be very difficult for someone like Axella to get himself back through the field to retain his former glory. So we've seen it happen before, where drivers have started at the back of the field and pushed their way through, and it's been a privilege to commentate on some of those things. But at a track like this, with a field as big as this, it's going to be very difficult.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be, you've got to make some positions up in turn one. So people like Gaxella, who you would expect to win if they're up front, he's really got to, go for it in turn one, try and make some positions up if he's going to win this race. But then again, we said that last year, and we've seen some real reserve driving from some of the drivers last year in race two, and it actually paid off, because the people up front don't normally race up front. They get a bit nervous and they make mistakes, so you can still win the race despite the fact you start from 15th, 16th. A couple of people complaining about the qualifying session, actually, which is quite surprising in some respects. I mean, you should expect, with a 45 car field, even on the big tracks, I mean, it's going to be insane when we get to places like Monaco. You should expect that there's going to be traffic with 45 cars trying to find lap time. I mean, I saw the beginning of the qualifying session when we were having the issues. I don't think the broadcast caught it, unfortunately. there were 12 cars stacked up in the final corner, trying to get a clean a lap. They were basically just sat doing 0 mile per hour in the final corner because they couldn't get a gap. So it's it is pretty insane, unfortunately.
Yes, and that is just part of us, as you said, of having that big of a field. But it's a field lineup for the second of this evening's race. Same distance, same rules apply, but a different man on pole position. It's Scott Cervic that will start on pole position this time around in front of Eric Tveit. And then you've got the rest of the field just behind them, as you can see on your screen at the moment. So the tensions rise once again here around Albert Park. It's a second chance for some of the drivers who may not have achieved what they would have liked to do in the first race of the afternoon, though they'll be looking to try and rectify that in the second. But also a chance for guys, it really opens up the championship, I think. So guys who, as we said, did not get a good start can establish themselves as title contenders by purely trying to get the best start they can. And if perhaps Scott Cervic in that Optimum Sim Racing team can get a great launch off the line and through those first couple of corners, we could well see him break away from the pack very much like Gigzella did.
Indeed, yeah, I mean, we saw last year some surprise winners up front in the second races because, like you say, if the leaders can't get through quick enough and someone can get a big gap up front, I think it was the Brazilian Grand Prix last year, David Junt was battling for the win and he didn't qualify higher than 10th for most of the season, so it can throw up some surprise results. The key in the race too, and the key to the championship, is for the fast guys to just be consistent and get a good result every race, because you can be easily taken out in this. I was going to suggest, do you want to quickly run down the field? We can do half each, something like that.
Yeah, sounds perfectly okay with me, because as you said, half each, there's still quite a lot of drivers, but on pole position is Scott Cervic, just behind Eric Tveit. It'll be interesting to see what sort of run he can get in that opening corner. Then you can see the man just behind him in P3, who's going to make it to try and capitalise on a mistake.
I'm not sure you can see the names actually, can you? So
yes.
I'll quickly run down it because it's going to be hard to switch to every person because of the stupid camera bug. But it's Scott Cervic, as you said, Eric Tveit, Mikko Jäkkinen in third, Mike Scroton fourth, Paul Joseph, Wupke Hoekstra, Ryan Gilmore, Jack Nichols, Juan Lopez, Benjamin Zirk are the top 10. Excuse me, after that we have Adrian McNaughton, Harry Nyman, Jarl Tien, our first race winner, Emmanuel Gaxeller, 14th position, so he's got some work to do. Rick Scott 15th, Tim Oliver Wagner in 16th, Rodney van der Zuurt 17th, Lee Palmer 18th, Tuomas Koriala 19th, he was quick, so watch him coming through. Kevin Vespal again, another one, watch him coming through. Brandon Warren 21st, Riku Saarpila, expecting better things from him. Thomas Jacobs, Alex Rolls, John McLean, Chris Parr, Chris Williamson, Doug Hillard, Mike Bell, Jan Schwitter, Andy Smith, Dave Simmons, this is up to 32nd position, Simon Melovich 33rd, Fabio Fontana, a familiar face actually, Fabio, quick shout out for him, I know him from Sim Racing Zone, messaged me today, good luck to him in race 2. Ricardo Mikluski 35th, Matt Webb, Nadir Khan, Sven Schubert, Ron Squire, William Neron, and that rounds out the top 30. In fact, no it doesn't, because we have one more person, which is Alejandro Fernandez in 41st position. And with that done, the formation lap's complete.
Indeed it is, so the drivers once again line up on their grid slots for what should be a very exciting race, to say the least. You're going to see a long line. It seems like an endless train, doesn't it, at this stage. But more importantly for the guys at the front of the field, those tyres are going to be getting very cold very quickly. So they'll be hoping everyone can park on their grid slots. And hopefully we see a much tidier start to the race compared to what we saw in the first one. And everyone can line up on their slots respectively and make sure there's no contact between anyone. So as you can see, that cloud of smoke in the background is everyone that's the last minute braking spots. And just try and make sure those brakes and tyres are all at fully working temperature. So we await those infamous red lights now. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 feet alleviated above the pedals, flat out, and we're away once again at Melbourne for the second race of the afternoon. Cervic's had a great start, but look at that from P4, I believe.
Huge accident. You look in the background.
Oh my
huge
goodness
accident.
Me.
That is a massive. Huge accident. There's cars everywhere in the background again.
That is over half the field, the top 20 just about making their way through. It's another spinner there, even more contact there, maybe a restart here. I wonder if there will be or no. Scott Cervic still leading the charge. You can see Ryan Gilmore just there as well, trying to hold on in P4 at the moment. But Cervic done very much what Gaxeller did in that opening race and held on very nicely. Tveit come under pressure at the moment in P2. Amazing to see, that's a massive incident back through the field. We've still got a lot of cars, I think 20 of them made it through the first corner without making contact, I believe. We'll see how this goes on, but Schroeter made a fantastic start off the line, got himself into P3, almost had a look for P2, but couldn't quite get it done, but now fancies his chances against current holder Eric Tveit.
Yeah, so far only three retirements, considering that huge accident in the background, so I'm not quite sure who started that. Obviously, we did see more of it this time in the first race. Suvik, like you say, got a good lead. Tvet in second position, but he's the one that's going to be challenging for the win here for sure. Ryan Gilmore, fourth, also very quick. He's on your screen now, trying to get past Mike Scroton in third position. Some changes going on in the background. Is that a car off in the background? Yes, someone's off in the background. Not quite sure who that is.
It's Lopez. Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's Juan Lopez has taken out, unfortunately, there.
And so, just like that, a weekend is turned on its head, and Lopez
Tvet
is
leads. Tvet leads, sorry. Tvet's just taken the lead on the outside.
Look at Gilmore as well.
There's there's carnage in the background. What's happened there?
Gilmore went to the inside, went to duck back in, thinking it would have worked. He's lost the back end and spun it. And I think another car may have collected him as well, just due to the sheer rapid change of direction. He may have got that one back on circuit, but more importantly, he would have lost that position. It's a right lead.
Gaxella, no front wing. Our race one winner's got no front wing. This is crazy. This has really opened it up for some people up front, especially people like Eric Tvet. Eric Tvet was in, there's loads of cars pitting. Look at all the cars coming down the pit lane. That's insane.
It's almost like there's been a massive weather change all of a sudden. I cannot believe the amount of cars on pit lane right now. Surely it's going to get very crowded. They can see Schroten trying to challenge once again. He's supported there by Herkstra, his teammate, who's trying to round the outside. That's very risky there. Oh, and he's made it. It's a beautiful pass.
Yeah, that was Suvik actually, and Herkstra in the two cars. It was Schroten in the red car. Obviously, Liam hasn't got the game open like I have, unfortunately, so we can't see some of the team's names. That was Zerka's retired as well. Juan Lopez is out, Zerka's out. There's quite a few cars out in this race, more than the first race already. So carnage in the second race. We saw a lot of the carnage as well, which involved Ryan Gilmore. But Tvet has opened up a 2 second lead, and the road opens up in front of him.
And it looks like history's repeating itself, doesn't it, right now? He's already got himself a massive lead, as we've said. But right now, you've got to be wondering what's going to happen. It's a bit further down this field. We've got almost an inter-team battle here with Schroten and Herkstra. And you've got to be wondering, are there going to be any team orders, do you think, at Optimum right now? Or are they just going to let them fight for themselves? But we take a look at Tayen, the man who took second in the opening race. Looking to try and come back now. He's got a much better run there as he looks to the inside line here. And to try and take P13, it's going to be a drag race into the next corner. He should have that one signed, sealed, delivered. And he makes a braking line. Perfect textbook manoeuvre there.
I'm just looking at Gaxella actually. It was a pretty quick wing change. He's in 23rd position, 46 seconds behind the leader. He could still get some points out of this yet. There's cars flying off everywhere, but Tvet, he's really making the most of this chance he's got, and he's pulling away up front. Team orders possibly, but maybe not this early in the season, I wouldn't have thought, especially between two guys who won't feature up front too much in some respects. No disrespect to each driver there, but they won't feature up front in the championship, so why not let them race, like, you, if you know what I mean.
So we should have to wait and see how this pans out. So we've been two laps down here, 13 to go at Albert Park, and you can see those clouds looking suspiciously grey all of a sudden. So I wonder if there's another twist in the tail. But right now, Eric Tvet has definitely taken that 12 and pulled it right out. You'll see he's got a massive 1.8 second lead. You take a look at the rear wing of Scott Cervic in the Optimum Sim Racing car right now, trying to pull away. But look at that, Lee Palmer seems to be on the pace. There's a massive 1 minute 40.992 there, so he's definitely pushing his way back through the field. Have to see where he can end up. He's currently P17.
Yeah, Lee Palmer started from the pit lane, I believe, so I'm not quite sure what he's doing. The track's not wet, so he can't be on wet tyres. Not quite sure what he's doing, but he's obviously hooked something up. He wasn't very prominent in the first race, but all of a sudden he's up there, so good job from him on the recovery. Tvet's gone off the track, and actually Hoekstra's catching him. So Tvet is pushing hard in the lead. As you see, is that Niemann running wide there? That's giving Gilmore the position. That moves Gilmore up to sixth place. Got that live on the broadcast. I can't even retaliate. He shouldn't do. Nope, he doesn't do. Hoekstra is really catching Tvet. Tvet's really struggling up front. I don't think it's raining or anything. No, it's not. It's not raining. But if you look at Tvet, he's really struggling. And Hoekstra's on the back of him. That was a 2 second gap the last lap round. It's now less than that. It's about, what, 7 or 8 tenths?
Indeed, you can see he's just breathing down his neck slowly, hasn't he? As those mistakes come, they're just going to slowly start multiplying now because he's going to be feeling the pressure of Herkstra. But of course, it's going to be interesting to see what Tvet can do from here. He knows what it's like to win a race at the top flight of sim racing. He's going to try and do the very much same thing here today and see what he can do. But how is Herkstra going to approach this? Is he going to start trying making moves here, there and everywhere? Well, he's trying to fight him a bit. As you can see, he's getting very dangerously close now to that rear wing. My suggestion will be he's almost doing like body punches in a fight. He's trying to weaken him. Ooh.
11th position. I'm not really sure what Ron Squire is doing, but he needs banning from this league, in my opinion, because he's become an absolute idiot. He got banned from the first race, but the race director really should kick Ron Squire from this race, in my opinion. He got booted from the first race, and he's just taken his teammate out and half the field nearly into turn one. I could see that happening a long time ago. Ron, whatever you're doing, just stop it. You're just a complete idiot. That really was not very professional at all from Ron Squire, what he's just done there. I'm sure his teammate will be absolutely fuming at that.
Yeah, turn as well, definitely trying to push through the field, but back towards his battle for the lead to Veit. Trying to still hold off Herkstra for the moment. He's looking fairly confident. He's not making as many mistakes. He's, well, if they are, they're very, very minor. And just trying to pull away, as you can see, Herkstra a little bit wobbly.
And Suvik makes a mistake in third position. Sorry, that's given Mike Scroton the run. And Mike Scroton's been forced to the outside line. Sorry for cutting in there, Liam. But in the background, he went off. And you see it's cost him. The momentum was too much. And that's cost Suvik the third position he held for a lap or two.
I wonder if we're able to fight it back as well. This is still very early stages in this race, but already it seems that some fates are being sealed as Cervic tries to push his way back through. He's already under pressure though, and has a long train of cars waiting on if he makes a mistake.
Yeah, Yael Tien's had another accident. He's now behind his teammate again in 12th position. Ron Squire in front of him, but I'm not going to watch that because that's no fun at all. But Tvedt really under pressure now from Hoekstra. Hoekstra's got a great run into turn. Off the turn two, now coming down the back, well, the small straight, he's got a great run, but Tvedt sticks to the inside. We'll switch to the TV camera view. Hoekstra's trying to go around the outside. Thinks better of it, but Tvedt locks the inside. He locks the rear up in trying desperation just to, and he's spun, unfortunately, in the gravel. Tvedt, another mistake. This is the second race now. Hoekstra takes the lead, and he's got a comfortable lead at that as well. We did say we could see some surprise winners in this race.
And I think that Vimy very much living up to the expectations. Optimum Sim Racing team boss right now must be thrilled with what he's seeing on his circuit. His drivers are currently first and third, although Scott Cervic's almost got himself a little train just behind. We'll see how this all forms out, but right now that battle for that entire top five is looking very, very feisty as Scrotus is trying to pull away from it as soon as he can. He doesn't want anything to do with the hustling and bustling which is going on just behind him.
Yeah, he's got Scroton in second position. He's got a slight gap to Sovic, and it's Paul Joseph, Ryan Gilmore, and Ari Nyman. Ari Nyman and Ryan Gilmore, the two fastest guys on the circuit the last time round, or the last few times round, so they need to get past this traffic. They can still win this. They're only 3 seconds off the lead. We've got 15 laps, obviously. Well, only 10 to go now. But Scroton doing a superb job as well. He's holding his position. Mike Scroton, it was his, I believe it's his brother or some sort of relation, obviously, Roy Scroton last year, who made the headlines with some of the races he made. But Mike up front in second position doing an awesome job, as you see in the background. Suvik getting very wide, which gives Paul Joseph the opportunity to try and go around the outside. And he's doing it. Look, he's doing it. Joseph takes him around the outside. An awesome manoeuvre there for the Paul Joseph Royal Blue Racing team.
Yeah, we said Royal Blue looking for a royal finish. They're definitely on course for that right now as they cross the line. He's got himself into a podium position, but only very briefly. We'll see what he can do and save it. Almost for a comeback. Gilmore, can he capitalise? Not quite. Gilmore, after making that mistake earlier on in the penultimate corner, has come back very strong. As you said, fastest man on the circuit, bringing Neiman and winning. He's definitely looking. He's got that winning blood in him, hasn't he, right now? He wants to try and be at the front of the field.
Yeah, and Gilmore's going to get past him. Gilmore's going to try and go around the outside there in the background. We're going to take a look. And he does make the move stick and just. Bit of contact there, but one man I'm just going to keep an eye on. Manuel Gaxella up to 13th already. He's absolutely flying through the field, and expect to see a fastest lap sign come up on the screen any second, I think, because he doesn't. He maybe had traffic, but he was absolutely flying up until that point. Suvik's dropped down to 6th now from 3rd in a matter of half a lap, so they're slowly but surely getting through. And just to quickly look at the retirements, we've got Melewisch out, Wagner out, Fontana out, Zirka out, Lopez, Coriala, Simmons, McLean, Schubert. Fernandez has also had a lot of retirements in this race. Someone else in the gravel just a moment ago there, so Hoekstra still leading though. And the second position battle is really raging. Joseph trying to take second position.
He is indeed. He is all over the back of Schroten right now, and you can see there, oh, they're jostling away. And just as we thought Schroten was pulling away, he's just been reeled right back in right now. Gilmore looks to the inside. He's just more important. I think that was more of a defensive maneuver than an offensive one, because he's got two very hungry cars just behind. A gaggle of four jostling for second position on board with Gilmore. Almost a bit of contact. He's made a mistake here once before. Does not want to repeat history. Gets a little bit loose, but can't quite make that move stick. They can see just behind though, it's coming under intense pressure from Joseph and the Royal Blue Racing team. And look at that, Scott Savings not too far away. To a tremendous battle right now. They can't go 3-1 into turn one. Surely that is not going to work. There's going to be a tremendous effort from Gilmore round the outside. Oh my goodness, it'll be a tremendous maneuver there.
Vestphal lost his wing in the background, not quite sure how, but you saw the wing fly up on the broadcast. Kevin Vestphal in the background for Logic's Razor, so another disastrous race for him. He's lost his front wing. And insane racing there to turn one. And, and there you see Vestphal off in the background. No, that's not Vestphal, that's Suvik. Suvik's gone off in the background. I thought it was Vestphal at first, but not. And Nyman there, just turn one, you saw Nyman's experience there. He eased off. They went three wide, but he backed off and let Gilmore and Scroton fight it out, and they got through cleanly. So great, great driving. But Hoekstra just pulled a 6 second lead during this. So this would be the challenge now for Gilmore. Can he hunt down Hoekstra, the 6 second gap?
It's going to be a challenge, isn't it? But there's only one way to find out. We've got 9 laps to go here, and already we can see a lot of pressure forming. That royal blue car can just try and maybe put another move on right now. It's got a great slipstream. We've seen passes here before. It can make or break a driver's race. Hopefully it's going to be make for him instead of a break. But very defending on the inside led. Joseph, again, he's left unscathed. He cannot quite get it done. Stroton, again, just like that, slipped down the field very much like Scott Sovic did. Both of these guys from within the podium positions have just been dwarfed by their competitors right now. And Stroton is trying to hold the inside line. Will he go deep? He doesn't. And there's no cutback for Joseph in that Royal Blue Racing team.
Yeah, just a quick shout. Tivette's also retired, so his race goes from bad to worse. He's crashed on this lap, I believe. And Gilmore is going to catch Hoekstra at this base because he's taken a second out in the final sector, from what I can see. Not quite sure if he had traffic, Hoekstra did, but they crossed the line. Hoekstra did a 30.3, a 40.3, and Gilmore only did a 40.0. So actually the gap's gone back up now, so maybe there is traffic, and you can see Gilmore's got Nyman all over him. Nyman's going to try and go the inside. No, he's not, because, oh, look at that, they just missed the backmarker there. Who was that? That was Rick Scott just getting out of the way there. Nyman trying to the outside, Gilmore forces him wide, and all this is helping Hoekstra up front, because he needs these two to badly if he's going to win this race.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's all very well, Gilmore tearing a tenth of seconds out of Hoekstra, but what if Gilmore's bringing Nyman with him, and just as I thought they could be working together for a mutual gain, they all start battling and bustling and hustling because they realise that 5 seconds adrift, 8 laps to go, they're not going to be able to push each other to that lead of the race without risking some sort of damage. They can see that battle, however, between Schroeder and Joseph, still holding on right now, dying to the inside, chops and changes lanes, but holds up the position for another corner, a massive run there out of the corner. For Paul Joseph, can he get a run though? These guys have been battling for quite some time now, and I can't see any sign of it ending anytime soon either. But again, at this corner, it's a scene of catastrophes and overtakes galore today. Some drivers feeling the urge and feeling the risk to try and put a move through there, but not many of them have been successful. You can see Lee.
I was saying, it's always a dangerous place to pass around here, but you can see Stroton's hanging on for dear life. But Joseph was unlucky in the first place, in my Paul Joseph was unlucky in the first place to be down in fifth position. He was battling for second position a moment ago, made one wrong move, and he got shuffled down to fifth in instant because there was four wide instead of one or something silly. So he's actually quicker than Stroton, and in the background there, who was that going very wide? Is that one of the backmarkers? That's not quite sure. It's Schwitter in the background. I believe he's pitted. And it is Schwitter in the background, but these two are still battling, raging on. And Gaxella is now in the top 10. Gaxella moves up to 10th position, and he's going to be into 9th position very soon, I would have thought. But Scroton, he's going to have to go to the inside soon because Joseph's going to lunge, is he? Joseph's going to look? No, he thinks better of it.
Yeah, it's all very key. He's still got half the race to go, guys. Don't get risking anything too great at this stage. It's all very well trying to make these big passes, but if it doesn't get you the position in the end, it's not going to be worth the risk. Josie's playing a very safe game right now, and that's both Royal Blue cars now I've seen perform very well in different circumstances, so they could very well be the underdogs in this championship right now. They get their way past the lap car very nicely. You take a look on board from the rear wing on Scroton at the moment. Joseph again looking on the attack here, but he can't quite get it done. Going in towards that corner, they come on towards that long straight again, and he still can't quite get it done.
Yeah, and Ryan Gilmore and Harry Nyman are still battling up front, which means that Hoekstra's still got a 4.1 second lead. It's still going to be close. They're still hunting him down at a half second a lap at the moment, and they can actually see Hoekstra now, so that's going to be a three-way scrap for the lead. Scroton goes very wide, but then there's cars off everywhere. Look at that. In fact, who was that? I thought it was Gilmore. It's one of the simming cars anyway. It's Nadir Khan who's just gone off the circuit. Another disastrous race for him, and he's now retired from the race. But yes, we have Hoekstra leading from Ryan Gilmore, Harry Nyman and Mike Scroton and Paul Joseph, the battle you're watching on screen. And in fact, look at Schwitter in the background of this, actually. These two are in 4th and 5th position. Schwitter looks like he's faster than these two, so he could be right up there if he hadn't had the earlier mayhem. But Suvik, who's fell to 6th position, still holding strong, though. Jacob, 7th. Jarl Tiern up in 8th position. Gaxella now in 9th position, which is pretty amazing considering he was 33rd a moment ago. And you see now Joseph trying to go down the outside again. Is he going to try? No, he can't do anything because Scroll Rick. Too late this time. No, that's giving Joseph the run, surely. Joseph does take the position. So very nice driving there from Joseph. He kept his head there, Paul Joseph, and it's worked out for him.
He has indeed, and I think he may have just been passed there as well. by a lap.
Whoa, look at this, look at this. That's a Batman.
That's for second place.
That's Ron Squire again. Please, someone ban Ron Squire from this race because he does not deserve to be in it. He's purely tried to take out the leaders there. That is completely ridiculous. And I can't believe he's still in the race, to be honest. I don't know what the admin's doing. I mentioned it earlier on after what I saw. Obviously, they haven't seen the same things as we have, but that was totally outrageous and disgraceful. Ron Squire, you're a menace.
Yeah, that's two incidents in the same race now for Ron. His future may not be looking quite so bright here in GPBWC, and I'm sure Ryan Gilmore must be so frustrated at that. He was in second last time around, has now lost a position now. I'm not too sure if this is due to Ron Squire or no, but one can only assume that the reason they were both tangled up together is because of some contact between them. And it's all about racing perspective as well, especially if you're a lapped car with a field this fierce. You need to be ready to get out of, move off your racing line and let the leaders through. And obviously Ron was not, regarding to that rule, not conforming to the rule, and has inevitably made some contact. So hopefully there's no damage to Ryan Gilmore's car and he can fight on another day. But Niemann has benefited from that greatly, it seems.
Yeah, he's doing it again, Ron Squire, as well. I don't know what the admin's doing, but it must be asleep because he must be able to see this, unless there's some reason he can't do it. But he needs to kick him now because he's just taken another car, I think, in the background. He's not doing it because he's unlucky or anything like that. He's doing it on purpose. You can see it. And in my eyes, if we see him again on the track, I'd be very surprised because they're supposed to be quite strict in GPWC about this. And so far, it's been pretty slack, to be honest, because he's still in the server. I'm not quite sure. I think our race happened to Dave Carr-Smith, who is actually my teammate. So, Dave, please kick him from the race if you can, because he's just probably robbed us of a great finish to the race as well, because I think Hoekstra has pulled another couple of seconds out of that.
Yeah, we'll wait for official confirmation as they cross the line. It was 4.2 last time around, and you can see 0.9 seconds of gap between them, and I'm pretty sure that stabilised. It was a fierce battle for second position. We take a look now at Webb in Epic Racing in P14, coming under a lot of pressure at the moment from Jack Nicholls. So Jack surviving all the carnage throughout the back and midfield. He's pushed his way almost into a top 10 position. He's a few positions off at the moment, but definitely looking to be in the hunt. Five laps to go here at Melbourne. What can Nicholls do? He's in the slipstream at the moment. Can he convert it into a move? 0.2 the gap, and he thinks about the move, but he realises he's a bit too far away. And surely right now it's just a case of trying to reel him in, corner after corner, lap by lap, and letting him know you're there, and just following the racing line. That's sometimes all it takes. It's that fear factor, the intimidation factor. Nicholls looks to the inside, feels he has enough momentum to make it stick. Very sensibly, Webb moves out of the way, looks for the cutback. But of course, he'll be on the dirty side of the racetrack, trying to sweep it around. There's a little bit of contact there. Sticks it over the curb very nicely. But Nicholls moves up into P14.
Yeah, I tell you who is flying now. Paul Joseph in fourth position. He got past Scroton, we saw. He's really put the hammer down. The lap after that, he put in his personal best lap, which was 0.7 faster than anything he'd done before. He's coming across the start finish line now. I'm going to see this lap time he does now. A 38.9, which is 1.2. Well, it's 2 seconds faster than he was lapping behind, and is he lapping faster than, he's actually lapping faster than the leaders. So Paul Joseph in 10th position, sorry, in 10th position, in the 4th position, he's only 10 seconds behind the leader and looking very competitive. So yeah, definitely impressed with Paul Joseph there. He played some really good cards when he overtook Mike Scroton. It took him a long time, but he kept his patience, and he's going to get a good result from this race if he keeps this pace up. He might even be able to challenge for a podium if anything goes wrong up front, because Gilmore and Niemann are very close together. Then, as you see, Gattella though, fastest lap 38.5, only 0.4 faster than Joseph though. So you see, and Westphal 10th position. Looking at Jacobs now, we're going to go on board. We're on board with Kevin Westphal in the Logix Razor Motorsport, trying to redeem something from this race. He's going to lunge up the inside, surely. Oh, you can see the back end squirming away as he tries to get it stopped, and Jacobs holds the outside line for the United Races Motorsports team and holds his position. This gives Westphal the exit though, and he's going to do it. Is he around the outside? Yes, and sensibly there, Jacobs backs out.
Yeah, second so position. Again, also back to second, and Gilmore's going to be hungry to reclaim what's his up the inside. There's a bit of contact, and Gilmore spun again, keeps it out of the wall. But almost a very nasty ending here. Gilmore, you can see how hungry he is. Four laps to go. He's pushing like a madman right now. He's like driving like a man possessed to take back what's his. That second position. Niemann and though doing a very good job at defending. This one's going to go down to wire, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I can really sympathise with Ryan in some respects, because I'd be very angry now if I were him, because he doesn't deserve to be behind Niemann. He was second. Or was he second? Was he behind him in the first place? Can't remember. But I think it was Niemann behind Gilmore at the point. You see Gilmore in the background getting very scruffy there. This is all Ron Squire's fault, basically, because he caused this. And I'd feel pretty... in fact, well, that has helped is Paul Joseph, who once again... It's a 30... Oh, no, he's 39.9, a second slower that lap, so I think he's had traffic as well. But there's looking down the field for a few more battles that are going on, and at the moment it's pretty quiet in some respects. This is the closest battle on circuit, or was the closest battle on circuit. Yeah, there's no one else on track at the moment. We're pretty close to having any overtake, so at the moment, we're the closest battle we have. And Nyman still can do this. He's got three laps, and you can see, if we look on board Nyman now, that's Hoekstra there, just in front of us, so we can still do this if we keep pushing. And if Gilmore doesn't attack us again, we can still do this.
Yeah, and he's going to be saying as well to himself right now that seeing that car in the distance, I'm sure you'll be able to confirm this yourself, is that when you see the leader just in front of you, you're in second, it's down to 1.5 seconds, now it's definitely there, as you can see Rick Scott dueling away in that other JRT machine for P22 with Adrian McNaughton. McNaughton looks to the inside after a successful first race, and look at that great defensive move from Scott, but he's touched the grass. McNaughton's going to be on the outside, goes as wide as he can to allow some recovery room, but he takes the position, so Rick Scott loses back down to 23rd.
Yeah, so we take a look further down the field for a second at some of the other guys who are battling. Obviously, we focused quite a lot on the upfront action so far, which we can't really apologise too much for because it's been insane. But yeah, Nyman only takes a tenth of a second out of the lead at that time. Gilmore in the background, as you can see. I think Hoekstra has got this. If Hoekstra can just keep it on the road. He's got Ron Squire now. Let's see what happens here. Hoekstra coming to lap Ron Squire. Ron goes to the inside.
Oh my, and again, well, to be fair, safely got off the circuit, but almost jeopardised.
Is he waiting for Gilmore? Because look what he's doing. Gilmore comes up now and he pulls back on the racing line. Now, I hope he moves out the way as he did with the other two for Gilmore, because if he tries anything now, it's a disgrace. And look at him blocking Gilmore. You can see there, he's just trying to block him. And will he try anything to the next corner? No. But he didn't make it easy for Gilmore, did he?
No, I mean, it could have been seen as intentional or no. We just have to wait and see what the final steward's verdict is at the end of the race, but it's not looking too promising for him right now. But with two laps to go, we've still got this battle here. Look at this. Previous race winner Gaczela is now on his way through the field as well, as he tries to catch Ron Squire's teammate Jean Tayen. And Tayen's had a very good race as well. Both these guys, first and second, now seventh and eighth. The question is, who's going to end up on top at the end of the second race? It's almost like anything you can do, I can do better scenario. And with only 1.5 laps to go, it's going to be very interesting to see who's going to want to try and put it all on the line to gain that position. Tayen reluctant to move off that inside line.
Whoa!
But he's gone a bit, very wide actually. Over the gravel trap he goes, takes a much more scenic route. Oh, almost slams into the wall, but keeps it on circuit. And just as I say that, I think I may have jinxed it there. And that has allowed Gaczela to pull up out in front and get an extra point advantage over him so far. Neiman and still in front of Gilmore. Gilmore reluctant. I'd love to see him actually come back and fight for his second position in the final lap, because he's fought so hard. He's overcome one incident in the open lap. He's been not exactly had the easiest race at all in terms of back markers either. And he's finally still not given up, has he? And that's very important as a racing driver. And Gilmore has just been fantastic today. Neiman's kept his nerve. Nichols up to P12. I said he might be in the hunt for a top 10 with only one more lap to go. He's not too far away at all, considering there's no more incidents up front. It will stay in P12. You've got Hillard there still trying to challenge for P13. He's not going to be able to do it this time, but Nichols has impressed me as well here today. He's had two very consistent, very clean races, but has found himself in so much action but kept his nose clean, which is what you want to see as a racing driver.
Yeah, he has been quick, hasn't he? I mean, he's been unlucky in this race to be taken back. We're going to switch back to, we look at first position. We've got Hoekstra in the lead, 2.9 seconds in front there, you see. And you see in the background, this battle's still not over. Nyman and Gilmore on the final lap. I don't think they're going to do anything about Hoekstra now. Hoekstra looks like he's going to take the win if he keeps it all together for the last few corners, and it'd be a great victory for him. But we're just going to keep an eye on this for a few seconds, just in case. Gilmore tries to hit the wall. Gilmore tries everything there to, that's going to cost him, is it? And could Paul Joseph get a podium now? Paul Joseph in the background, but we'll go back to Hoekstra because he's coming around the final few corners. Liam, I'll let you take it. I'll keep an eye on Joseph.
So history is repeating itself here once again at Albert Park. Hoekstra, who's done a superb job for Optimum Sim Racing here today, he's going to take their first victory of the season, their debut in the GPV WC Formula Challenge. And Hoekstra swerves in elation and he crosses the line and takes his first GPV WC victory of the season. There you can see a very happy Neiman in his second. Gilmore is going to hold on to P3, and there is Joseph, just close but no cigar, as he comes across the line in P4.
Yeah, more bad news for Tian in 8th position. He's got no front wing. He's had another accident. That's Vestfahl behind him. He's going to take more points off him. Or is he? Because he's really defending hard. It's Tian. He's going to try and hold his position, but I don't know if he can. He blocks the apex there with no front wing. Vestfahl, launch it down the outside. No, yeah, do it. Go. He's trying it, but it doesn't quite work. Oh, and Vettel gets sideways on the curb, so it didn't quite work out, that one, unfortunately. We have Mike Scroton finished 5th, Scott Savick 6th, Gaxella a great 7th comeback drive from how he got on early on in the race. Jarl Tiern 8th, as you see coming across the line, Kevin Vassar 9th. Jacobs in 10th position, solid race from there. Or will he take, yeah, I think that's for battle as well. And that's Jacobs and McCluskey coming across the line, and it's going to be Jacobs who takes it. A very close race there. Jack Nicholls in 12th position, just misses out on the top 10 there, Liam.
Yeah, he does indeed. It could have been. You never know what's going to happen in these final laps, but he'll be very delighted with that as well, especially if he saw that cloud of smoke at the start of the race. You never know what's going to happen when you're in that midfield, but he will be elated with that result. As you can see, the rest of the field just getting their way through. Now, it's been a very impressive weekend, actually, despite all the carnage we've seen at the start of the two races. The field have been very consistent and very respectful of one another. With the series with these cars are very unpredictable at times, and the drivers can be very aggressive in trying to get what they want. It's been a very respectable race, and the racing has been very clean, and in turn has given us some of the most exciting stuff to commentate on.
Yeah, I mean, there's been a few idiots, as you always get, but, I mean, the accidents are just part of racing. Chris Williamson comes across the line, our final person on the lead lap. So good job from Chris actually there to finish on the lead lap. Yeah, there was a lot of retirements in that race though, and a lot of crazy driving. Not quite sure why one of them was still allowed to race, but hopefully that will be sorted, because if I ever see him on track again, I would be ashamed to be racing in the league, to be honest. He races in that. That is Ron Squire, because it was on purpose what he was doing. There was no doubt about it in my mind.
As we said, we have to wait and try and see the steward's verdict at the end of the race, but his future is not looking too promising at all. But at the end of the first race, I mean, Lee, is there any driver that stood out to you in particular throughout both races today? Like, is there a Mr. Consistency that sprung to mind?
Well, both races, you've got to say Gaxella, obviously, for the championship perspective. Let's look at the championship perspective first, I would have thought, is that Gaxella, he excelled, really. He won the first race and he came back from a loss front wing to finish 7th in this race and pretty much secures his lead of the championship, let's say. But Hoekstra obviously did well in the second race, very controlled. Man of the race in the second race for me was Paul Joseph.
I think I'll have to agree with both of your decisions there as well. Supreme races by them both, and Joseph just did everything he could. He almost got rewarded for all his hard work with a third position, but it wasn't quite to be. But they'll be looking to try and continue that momentum in Royal Blue Racing as they head in towards the second round of the championship.
Yeah, considering the problems we had early on, it's been a good broadcast. Obviously, we've had some positive comments from the people who've been watching. We thank you very much for tuning in. Hope we'll see you again. Obviously, we've got the Super Cup tomorrow and then the Super League on Thursday, so it's an action-packed week of racing at GPWC, as always, and we've got all this to look forward to through the summer. But as you know, this race was run by Wupke Hoekstra, and I'm really surprised, actually. I didn't expect him to be able to continue. I mean, he set a good pace in race one. He was battling quite hard, but I didn't expect him to be able to keep them behind. But Nyman and Gilmore had issues. I think it'd have been a lot closer. I think we were robbed of a great race between all three of them at the end by Ron Squire, which is why I'm slightly annoyed at him, because they were catching him pretty quickly, and it would have been a great three-way battle for the lead, I reckon.
Yeah, it just should have been, could have been, should have been. Sort of thing. I think I'm repeating myself two times, but you know, there's at this stage in the calendar as well, you can't dwell on sort of bad results, because it's always a bit in between. You never know what's going to happen. But the big point is here, especially for people like Gaxella, is they've got those banker points in. They've got that all-important first victory, and the team will be delighted with that. And the last thing you want to do is be getting towards the end of the season and having to work your socks off to try and get those points that you've missed out on, or maybe made some mistakes you regret in the opening couple of races. So in that respect, it's been a very strong championship charge already from Gaxella, but we'll see what he can bring to the Malaysian Grand Prix.
Yeah, in the channel, I've just brought Kevin Vestfall in from Logic's Razor Motorsports, sorry, it changed since last year. Yeah. Logic's Razor Motorsports, Kevin comes into the channel. Welcome, Kevin. I'll let Liam do the interview if you want.
Yeah, so Kevin, I mean, that must have been a frantic weekend for you today, but overall, how did it go for you?
Yeah, I was quite excited about the position of the qualifying. I never expected that. I just thought about maybe top 10 or something like that, but I never expected such a high place for me, because I just jumped in for a week because Eric Teske, the normal driver, just said, nope, I don't want to drive, and then I said, okay, I will do it. That was good, but I don't know what happened in the first race. Someone pushed me into the grass. Maybe there were more people involved into that. Yeah, that ruined my first race, I think, but yeah, that happens. And second race, just racing. Finished in 9th, and 9th, that's good.
Yeah, I mean, going into Malaysia as well, I mean, what's the team morale going to be like? Because in the end, it was a mixed race for you, as you said, but you got that all-important ninth place and got some big points for the team. So where do you think you'll go from here? Do you think the team will be very happy and confident looking into the second round of the season?
I think we have to train and practice some more. The other drivers, I can say, are just thinking of being too fast. They have to train more. We all have to do that. It's a hard way that we have to go now. I think we have really tough work for in front of us, but I think in the end we can manage to get into top 10 in every race.
Awesome. Well, it's great to hear from you, Kevin. We thank you for your time coming in for a short interview, and I'm sure we'll let you go and cool down now after what must have been a very tense couple of hours for you.
Yeah, really intense. I don't know. So I'm just spending so much now.
Okay, well, we'll let you go. You'll have a drink and cool down. Thank you for your time, and we shall see you in Malaysia.
Oh, thank you. Bye, Lee. Bye, Liam.
Cheers, Kevin. I've just popped Scott Sovic up into the channel. I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly. Scott Sovic, obviously today we saw him feature in the second race predominantly, and he finished up in sixth position, I believe. So, Liam, I'll let you take it away again.
Yeah, so Scott, I mean, Optimum Sim Racing must be extremely happy right now. They've taken a victory and a pole position as well. But how was your second race especially? You started at the front of the field, but it didn't quite all go to plan for you.
No, it was... Being at pole, I was a bit surprised. I didn't think it would be the top 15 that were reversed. I thought it was the entire grid, so I was a bit surprised. But I kept my calm during the start, and it went quite well from there, I feel. But some mistakes on the way, like braking too late for turn three. But sixth, after a bit of mayhem on the way, it's not bad. I don't think that is bad at all.
No, not at all. You performed very consistently as well to bring home some big points. And what's the morale going to be like in the Optimum Garage right now? I mean, surely the whole team must be delighted of what you've achieved this race.
Boy, brilliant, actually. I think this is the first pole position Optimum Sim Racing has ever had, unless I'm mistaken. But yeah, morale is going to be very, very high for Malaysia, hopefully. And hopefully we can do a good job there as well.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. You've hit the nail on the head there. Going into Malaysia, as you said, the morale's going to be high. And knowing that you can achieve this good result, you've got the pace there, you've got the consistency. Do you think you'll be able to achieve a similar result into the second round?
Well, I don't know about Wopke, but I can try. I can try. Malaysia's not my strongest track, but, you know, give it a go.
Okay, awesome stuff. Well, thank you for your time, Scott, and we'll also go let you cool down and rejoice in what must have been a fantastic achievement for yourself and Optimum Sim Racing.
Yep, thank you, Scott. I think that pretty much sums it up, really, Liam. Obviously, like you say, Malaysia, 2 weeks' time, we've got the Super Cup tomorrow.
Yeah, so another fantastic broadcast on the way for GPVWC. A massive thank you to everyone who's tuned in and stayed with us, because it was at a stage where this broadcast wasn't going to happen. We've had so many issues along the way that we hope that myself and Lee have provided you with enough entertainment to make it worth your while. So also a massive thank you to Lee, my co-commentator for this evening. And so from him and myself, we will see you in 2 weeks for the Malaysian Grand Prix. Take care, and we'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yeah, just quickly, I just have to say as well, Liam, you did an awesome job tonight, considering the problems you had, so catch you all later.